Alabama has built another dynasty in Tuscaloosa. The legend of Bear Bryant lives on in Nick Saban. If he continues to rack up wins and titles at this pace, he'll get a street named after him next to Bear Bryant Drive. The Tide continues to roll week to week on their quest for a third straight national title. While Alabama smashes their way through SEC play, things have not been so smooth for the Razorbacks. First-year coach Brett Bielema's team has struggled, but have an emerging superstar in freshman Alex Collins. Saban and the Tide know that nothing is given in college football. One lapse, one misstep, one mistake can cost a team a national title. A win makes Arkansas season. A loss kills Alabama's. Tonight, it's the Hogs and the Tide in Tuscaloosa next. ESPN's College Football Primetime presented by Hampton Hotels. Our matchup in the SEC West from Bryant Denny Stadium. It's the Razorbacks of Arkansas and the Crimson Tide of Alabama. Welcome everybody to Tuscaloosa. I'm Brad Nussler with Todd Blackledge. Well, Edge, they ended the season number one last year. They started the season number one in the preseason rankings. Here they are, 6-0, still number one, and hitting their stride, I think.
Yeah, I think you're right. You know, defensively, after the A&M game when they gave up 42 points and over 600 yards, since then they've returned to their dominant style of play. Offensively, we saw them a couple weeks ago. The big question mark was their offensive line. The last two or three weeks, that unit has played much better. Their offensive run-pass balance has come back into the fold, and this is a team that is trending the right way.
And they've got a two-headed tailback situation like they've had in past years. How about Arkansas? They started off 3-0. They've lost four straight.
Yeah.
Are they just going to become victim number seven, or do they have what it takes to pull an upset?
Well, they've proven they can run the football on everybody that they've played. And up until the second half of last week's game, even though they hadn't won, they competed and they fought, but they cannot repeat what they did in the second half last week against South Carolina. If they don't play their best game of the season in all facets, these little pigs will go wee, wee, wee all the way home with a fifth loss in a row.
And it would be 11 straight wins for the Crimson Tide of Alabama if they can pull it off at Bryant-Denny Stadium tonight. Nick Saban's got his Tide gathered. We'll kick it off after we talk with Holly when we return in a minute.
ESPN College Football Primetime, brought to you by Taco Bell. Sometimes you gotta live más. And Expedia. Expedia helps 30 million travelers a month find what they're looking for, one traveler at a time.
The SEC on ESPN from Tuscaloosa. The number one team in the country. At 6-0, at perfect in conference play at 3-0. 43 straight, they've won against unranked opponents. As we take a look at the standings in the West, it's the top and bottom. But don't forget, we've already had a couple of upsets in the conference today. Alabama might get a little bit stronger even tonight. They've got another player coming back. Holly's got more on that.
Well, late yesterday afternoon, Alabama heard from the NCAA that they had reinstated safety Ha-Ha Clinton Dix. Now, this is big news for Alabama because he is a big physical safety, maybe the best in the country. But the problem, Nick Saban told me before the game, is that they didn't know how to practice with him this week, not knowing if he'd be available or not. So he didn't get starters reps. He may not start this game. He said we'll probably use him more so in nickel and dime situation. But, guys, his return is really big for Alabama. This is kind of the first regular personnel team that they have faced offensively. They've got a lot of shifts and motions, particularly with their big tight ends. They're planning on using cornerback Landon Collins, who's normally a safety on some of those tight ends. So to have another big body at 6'1", 185, Ha-Ha should help Alabama tonight.
Okay, Holly. Nick Saban, pretty rarefied air when you talk about one of three coaches with three national titles. And trying to make it another this year. Halfway there. More than halfway there. Brett Bielema, on the other hand, first year after a successful, very successful stint as a head coach at Wisconsin. Three straight Rose Bowls to end his time there, and this is his 100th career game as head coach tonight. Alabama won the toss, and they want the football. And that means an offense that's averaging right at 450 yards per game. It is perfect It's one of those Chamber of Commerce days in Tuscaloosa. A hint of fall in the air at 67 degrees.
And I would say, when I said Arkansas needs to play their best game in all three facets, that includes this opening kickoff, because where Alabama has maybe struggled a little bit early on and offensively, defensively they've had some issues, special teams have been outstanding from start to finish, and Christian Jones has been the main guy in the return game for Alabama.
There he is with DeAndre White back deep. Zach Hocker has it teed up for Arkansas. Christian Jones has both a kick and punt return for a score this year. He waits on the other end, and we're underway in Tuscaloosa. And it's Jones, 5 yards deep. Straight up the middle, and a good return out across the 30-yard line. A.J. McCarron. He's got as many rings as he does losses in his career. That's not bad, is it?
It isn't. And you know, sometimes he's gotten a bad rap. People want to just label him as a game manager. He is a tremendous game manager, but he's much more than that. He has the ability, arm talent wise, to make any throw you want. And he plays his best in the biggest moments in the biggest games. That says a lot about him as a competitor.
He'll set his team up at the 32-yard line in the shotgun. T.J. Yeldon with him. He's going to flare it out to Yeldon out of the backfield. And T.J.'s got a good gain of about 8 before he's knocked out of bounds. As we take a look at tonight, our Chick-fil-A impact players. Offensively for Alabama, Kenyon Drake, though he's not a starter, he's becoming a main cog in their offense. Amari Cooper getting healthier, had a toe problem. They expect big things from him tonight. And Chris Smith and Trey Flowers defensively for the Razorbacks combined for 10 sacks on the season already, so they could make it a difficult night when A.J. McCarron's trying to pass. Second down and a long yard for Alabama just across its own 40-yard line. And it's Yeldon, and he's got the first down. And out close to the 45.
You mentioned in the open that they've got that two-headed monster going at tailback now with Yeldon and Drake. Both guys went over 100 yards last week in the win against Kentucky. And boy, that just keeps them fresh for four quarters. And they've always had that here when Alabama has been at their best.
Two tight ends set here on a first down at the 45.
Heavy play action team on first down.
In the pistol, there's the play action bootleg. And he wants to go long, airing it out. It's got a man just overshot Kenny Bell. Bell had a step back there on Eric Bennett.
And this is where their offense is starting to gel now. The offensive line has played much better the last 3 weeks. And so they've run the ball better, and that sets up their play action. They get their big yardage plays out of the passing game on play action passes. In the last three games, it has really started to come together.
You saw over 1,000 yards difference after some close encounters earlier in the year. Four wide receivers set here for McCarron on second down and 10. But they'll keep it on the ground and get very little. Maybe a yard for Yeldon. And Byron Jones in on the stop, along with Braylon Mitchell. And Byron Jones wearing number 98 tonight instead of his normal number. And that's in honor of Robert Thomas, one of their captains who they lost to a broken leg last week. Alabama 48% on their third down conversion so far in the year. McCarron, pressure from the middle, got the pass away, and it's going to be a first down to Kevin Norwood by about a foot.
Nice job by A.J. McCarron, knowing that it was a guy coming free right up the middle. Watch him just continue to backpedal away from the pressure until he picked up his crossing route. Just enough time before the rush got to him to get the ball to Norwood, who's a bigger receiver at 195 pounds, able to stretch for that first down.
Two tight ends again after picking up the first down at the 45 of Arkansas. McCarron flips it out to Yeldon with a blocker in front. And he'll have another first down and then some. pickup of 12 more and some tough yards after the catch. And Byron Jones got back there to make the stop again.
Well, missed tackle by Braylon Mitchell, number 34, the linebacker. He's going to be out there. He reads the play fairly well. Slips underneath the block, but not able to make the tackle on Yeldon. And Yeldon running tough for the first down.
So a good-looking opening drive here for the Tide. Worked it down just outside the 32-yard line of Arkansas. Seventh play of the drive upcoming. And it's Yeldon straight up the middle. Let's check in with Holly.
Well, as you said, senior Robert Thomas broke his leg. He's out for the season. So Brett Bielema had the idea to let someone wear his jersey in his honor. He's been such a big part of this team, and they even let him pick who would get to wear it. So Robert picked Byron tonight. But more so, they let him speak to the team. Robert was a little surprised, according to Brett, but he spoke to the team and said, you know, I wish I could be there playing with you, but they are inspired, certainly in his absence, by Byron wearing his number.
And so that 98 will go to somebody special every week. And Robert, we wish you the best in your rehab from your broken leg. Here's a toss out to Jones. Keeps his balance. Hasn't gone down yet. And he's going to be very close to a first down. Christian Jones put his hand on the ground, stayed upright, and it's going to be just shy of the first down.
Pretty good job by Tevin Mitchell, though, the cornerback over there, number 8, reading the play, getting there quickly. This is a dangerous guy in space. I mean, that's what makes him such a good kick and punt returner, his ability to make people miss in space. That time Mitchell did a good job slowing up enough to get other guys there to make the tackle.
Alabama brings in extra tight end DeAndre White, the only wide receiver, on a third down and a yard. And it's Yeldon, and he's got it easily down to the 20 before he's swarmed under by the Razorback defense. And they still don't have him down. So here they are in the red zone already in the opening 4 minutes.
We talked about that offensive line. We were here for the Ole Miss game a few weeks ago, and their starting center, Ryan Kelly, got hurt in that game, and Chad Lindsey had to come in. And Lindsey's been the starter ever since. Young man out of the Woodlands, Texas, has done a nice job taking the place of Ryan Kelly. Kelly is healthy now and able to play, but Lindsey has played well while he's been out.
McCarron, play action. Wants to throw on first down. Crossing route complete. Amari Cooper, first and goal, Alabama. And you hear the chants of Coop, one of our impact players, and just made one there.
Well, Amari Cooper has had kind of a slow 2013. He had a toe injury in camp. It's bothered him. He hasn't been able to practice 100% all the time. But last week, he showed those signs of what he did all of last year. He had 4 catches a week ago. He had a good week of healthy practice. And it's good to get him involved in the game early tonight for A.J. McCarron.
So first and goal at the Arkansas 7. Yeldon, right in the middle of the pile, to the 5, maybe even to the 4. There he is, filing in on the tackle.
Already you're seeing in this first possession the run-pass balance. I mean, that is what has made Alabama's offense the last few years so difficult to deal with, because they've got the power running, and that running game is starting to kick in now, coming into tonight up to about 188 yards a game rushing. And then, of course, A.J. McCarron with his experience and great skill weapons on the outside. Very dangerous team to defend.
And you saw on this drive, the 12th play, 6 passes, 5 runs, second and goal. Play fake, McCarron just floats it out, wide open. Justin Fowler, touchdown. That was just too easy.
Yep. Justin Fowler is lined up in a wing position. He's just going to hesitate, show block, and then release out, and nobody goes with him. I think that's a mistake by the linebacker. Spate, number 47, did not stay with Fowler on that play.
Extra point by Cade Foster. Up and good. What a way to open up the game. A.J. McCarron, 6 out of 7 on the drive to 5 different receivers. Not a bad start. And the 6th completion was an easy one to his fullback, Fowler, to cap off the drive. 7-0 tied. Those are not game manager numbers. Those are really good quarterback numbers. Let's take a look at how Alabama's finding success tonight, brought to you by Expedia.
Well, the run-pass balance set it up, and when they got to the last play, it's basically a three-man route. You got a tight end going deep. Fowler's going to show block and then release. And then DeAndre White's the back of the end zone. A.J. really had two of the three wide open. Took the easiest throw. Jalston Fowler, a very versatile guy with soft hands. Only his fourth catch of the season, but three of those for touchdowns.
So you know why Alabama wanted the football when they won the toss. They go 68 yards on a 12-play drive. Just under 6 minutes used to get a touchdown lead. Kick will be returned from the four. Marshall from there. And he's hit at the 20 and goes down on the kick return. That's where Arkansas go to work after we check in with Reese Davis. Reese.
Brad, Taco Bell Studio Update, a thriller in College Station. Texas A&M and Auburn. Auburn up 38-34. Johnny Manziel returning to the game after injuring his shoulder. Puts A&M up. Just under a minute and a half to go. Trey Mason puts Auburn back up 45-41. And right now, A&M has the ball inside the Auburn 20, and Manziel just got sacked at the 25. Half minute to go in College Station.
All right, Reese, give us an update when it's over. First down, Arkansas at its own 20 with Brandon Allen at the controls. And the crowd, they know how to work it. Very quiet on Alabama's opening drive, making noise here for their defense. And that's why one of the best defenses in the country on a yearly basis, and no gain on the play. This guy's had some shoulder issues and is coming off a poor outing in their loss to South Carolina last week.
Yeah, he's had a rough go of it. You know, he's a young starter, a sophomore. His first start ever was last year against Alabama, and that was a real baptism by fire. But his shoulder is finally feeling better, and he finally had a full week of practice. Up to that point, the first 4 weeks, he only threw on one day of the week, on Wednesdays. He got to throw for 3 days this week. They feel much better about it.
Here's a draw play. That's going nowhere either. Jonathan Williams stopped for no gain. Jonathan Allen made the tackle as we take a look at our Chick-fil-A impact players offensively and defensively for these groups. Alec Collins, one of the great freshman running backs in the country. Hunter Henry, a freshman tight end. They expect a big night from him. He's averaging almost 20 yards a catch. And Kirby Smart said, we have to be tough on the inside up the middle. That means Trey DePriest and Vinny Sinceri at the second and third levels of that Alabama defense have to be strong tonight. And there's Ha-Ha Dixon and Holly Sid. That he'd be a part of the package tonight. Allen running for his life. And he's going to be sacked way back at the 16-yard line. So that wasn't a good opening start for the Arkansas offense.
You know, four-man rush, great coverage down the field. That's what forced Allen to leave the pocket. And Denzel Duvall was right there to wrap him up for a loss of yardage. So two plays for zero and then a loss of yardage on third down.
Low snap. And just getting the punt away is Erwin Hill. Let's see where they're going to spot this. Going to be great field position. It's going to be in Arkansas territory. Wow. That's not good. 38-yard line for Alabama on offense when we come back.
ESPN College Football Primetime is presented by Hampton Hotels. Feel the Hamptonality. And in part by Nissan, premier partner of the Heisman Trophy.
Bears office. His team up 7-0. Welcome back to the Dr. Pepper's road to the conference championships. This is not what you want to do.
No.
With the number one team in the country is kick a 22-yard punt and have them start at the 38-yard line.
And if you're Arkansas right now, you better be prepared for a play action deep shot right here. They've got their two speed receivers in, and Kenny Bell and Amari Cooper, both to the right of the formation.
Kenyon Drake is the tailback. Vogler, the tight end, sets up. There's the play fake. Here comes A.J. McCarron. Oh, maybe he's not going to get it off. buys himself some time and now does fire deep on the sideline, and it's complete to Amari Cooper and a pickup of 21.
Well, that's just tremendous patience by an experienced veteran quarterback. A young quarterback is going to go ahead and force that ball down the field. He wants to throw deep to Cooper, but the safety's there to help. It's not open. And so McCarron just buys time, and then hits Cooper late on the adjustment to the scramble. A young quarterback forces that throw. A veteran guy waits and makes a key play.
Perfect throw to the sideline, and a first down inside the Arkansas 17, just like that. The stretch play to Drake, trying to get to the corner, and he does. Run out of bounds on the far side after a pickup of 5.
The difference between Drake and Yeldon. Drake is a little sleeker body. He's got more explosiveness with the ball in his hands, not quite as physical as Yeldon, and he's still growing and learning as a young back. He's also a sophomore, as is Yeldon, but Yeldon played so much last year that in terms of pass protection and those kind of things, he's ahead of Drake. But Drake is a very explosive guy when the ball's in his hands.
And like when it was Trent Richardson and Eddie Lacy, always two guys, always fresh legs, and both one's as dangerous as the other. Second down and 5, just outside the 10. And breaking tackles is Drake, trying to stretch to the goal line. He got to the 1. Trey Flowers knocked him off his pins, but it's first and goal.
Just a little zone play. Just kind of look for a crease. Got those big-bodied offensive linemen up there. Wait for something to pop open. Drake almost gets it to the end zone.
A third tight end in there, as is the fullback Fowler. First and goal, Alabama already leading by 7 with 5.5 minutes remaining first quarter. Drake spins. Got close, but not in. Martrell Spates was the first guy that got there. It'll bring up second down and goal from about the 1-foot line.
Now Drake has the option of cutting that wherever he thinks he sees a crease. A little surprised he didn't stay right on the hip of his fullback Fowler on that one. Fowler went wide, and he cut inside thinking he could get the touchdown, but was stopped short.
We'll make it the 2-foot line.
I bet he follows Fowler this time.
Second down and goal, Alabama. Bogler, the tight end, in motion, sets up to the left. He follows his fullback and walks in. Touchdown, Alabama. That's not what Brett Bielema had planned in the opening 10 minutes of the ball game.
Well, Anthony Steen, this is power football. The right guard pulls, the fullback leads. Two big bodies blocking on linebackers. An easy touchdown for Alabama.
They got a short field, and they didn't take long getting it back in the end zone. Cade Foster's extra point is right down the middle. 4:36 remaining in the first quarter. And the top-ranked team in the country already with a head of steam. 1-yard touchdown caps off a 5-play drive, and it's 14-0. Get your NFL Sunday started tomorrow morning at 10 a.m. Chris Berman and the gang with all the latest news and updates from around the league right up to kickoff. Plus, Ray Lewis sits down with Rex Ryan to talk about the Patriots-Jets showdown at 11 on ESPN2. You can catch Fantasy Football Now for all the latest news, injury reports, and predictions for the top fantasy performers. Well, if you had a fantasy performer tonight, it'd either be A.J. McCarron or Kenyon Drake so far. A&M did lose 45-41, and I think Reese is going to tell us how it happened. So there have been 4 upsets in the SEC already today. Arkansas would like to make it 5, but right now they're down 2 touchdowns. Here's Hatcher, who got pasted as he crossed the 20 at the 22-yard line. The aforementioned Reese Davis. What do you got, Reese?
Brad, somebody stealing my thunder, putting up the sign that said A&M lost. This is your Dr. Pepper 10 conference update. 4th and 13, last chance for A&M against Auburn. Manziel was in agony. His shoulder was hurting, and Auburn swallowed him up. What a win for Gus Malzahn. 45-41. Auburn wins it on the road.
So Auburn is back with a vengeance, and we've got a down player, and it's Vinny Sinceri, I think, a starting safety and a key cog in that Alabama defense down there on kick coverage, and hopefully he's okay. Vinny, one of our impact players. He's had a great year so far. A couple interceptions, both returned for touchdowns. He's that last line of defense for him back there at safety.
Smart guy too. You know, I mean, he's athletic. I mean, he can run and he can change directions, but his intelligence and his ability to get guys lined up and get the coverages set is really what makes him a valuable player in the back of the Alabama defense.
So funny listening to him talk about his mom Roxanne telling the story about when you played his dad in a game that you were down a couple touchdowns and then beat Pittsburgh pretty bad. He almost didn't want to come into the meeting room. He's afraid to bring it up. And again, Alabama's pressure getting to Allen. And he's got to throw it away.
Now this couldn't have started any worse for Arkansas right now. They've not gotten a positive play yet on offense. They had a bad punt, and their defense has not been able to even figure out how to begin to slow down the Alabama offense. So again, Brandon Allen has not had a great amount of success so far this season. Coming into the game, only 48% completion, but he's going to have to make a couple plays. They've got to loosen up the Alabama defense. The guy that he can look to is Hunter Henry, number 84, has been a good receiver at the tight end.
There's play fake. The toss out complete to the fullback, Kiero Small. And Small gets out to the 30-yard line, pick up a 7, still going to bring up a 3rd down and 3.
Yeah, but a manageable 3rd down, different than 3rd and 10.
Yep.
You know, against this Alabama defense, they're so complex in their coverage schemes that you got to give yourself a chance. If you get 3rd down and 7 or more against them, it is very, very difficult. They're not a heavy blitz team. They're a heavy coverage team. 3rd and 3, you've got more options.
Alabama, as you can see, one of the best in the country preventing 3rd down conversions. Shotgun here. Alex Collins in the backfield with Brandon Allen. Allen wants to throw. Now he's going to run for the 1st down, and he's got it.
Good decision. He was looking for Hunter Henry first, and Hunter Henry was covered, and he made a very good decision, and there was no hesitation on his decision, and that's the important thing. See, he wants to throw to 84 in a little delay route. Alabama was in tune to it, and Allen made a great decision to run, and because he didn't hesitate, he was able to get the 1st down.
You saw the brain trust on the sideline over there as Sinceri looks like he's heading to the locker room. Nick Saban and Kirby Smart, two defensive-minded coaches, screaming out there because they just allowed a 1st down. That's kind of how this Alabama defense thinks. The players are the same way. They don't even like giving up a 1st down. Allen has to throw it over the rush. Got it to Collins, and Collins dragged down by Landon Collins.
See, that's not a good throw by Brandon Allen. Again, accuracy is the thing that shows up on tape that has been his problem. That's a ball you have to throw in front of the numbers of a running back so he can catch it and make that first guy miss out in space. Because Collins had to reach back for it and slow down, that enabled Landon Collins to get there and tackle him for no gain.
So 2nd down and 10 here in the final 2.5 minutes, 1st quarter. Collins stays in there at the tailback spot. 3 wideouts for Allen. It's going to be Collins, a freshman. Oh, man, did he get met in the hole after a pickup of maybe a yard. And then we got some pushing and shoving going on. C.J. Mosley, I think, is the guy that collided with him.
You have 2 of the starting 5 offensive linemen for Arkansas are true freshmen. The left guard, Dan Skipper, number 76. The right guard, Denver Kirkland, number 55. Last year playing high school football, going against a physical, big in stature defense like Alabama. This is a real challenge for those 2 young guys.
And as you saw Skipper come out of that huddle, if he looked like a really big guy, he's 6'10", playing guard. Here's the 3rd and long and the blitz from the secondary. The throw is on target, and it is Hunter Henry. Great throw that time. And Henry, one of our impact players, the freshman tight end, a pickup of 25.
Well, it was a good read by Brandon Allen because the blitz was coming right where he was looking for Henry. And C.J. Mosley was responsible for coverage. The blitz came from the secondary. Mosley had to turn and pick up the tight end. and he was beat right away, and a nice throw by Brandon Allen.
It was Ha-Ha Clinton Dix who came from the secondary on the blitz and a perfect toss. And now the seventh play of the Arkansas drive has got him on Alabama's end of the field for the first time tonight at the 40-yard line. Allen play fake, has time, another deep toss going to the same guy, intercepted by Clinton Dix. And he makes an impact after missing a couple of games with an interception.
Well, they beat the linebacker one play. They tried to go to the well a second play in a row, and this time the underneath linebacker coverage got a hand on the football. Trying to go to Henry again. This time C.J. Mosley said, nope, I'm going to tip the ball, and my guy's going to get the interception.
Visit WatchESPN.com or download the WatchESPN app to watch ESPN live anytime, anywhere. Brought to you by Vizio.
Ha-ha. Clinton Dix interception his first of the year, fifth for the Alabama defense, and they got the ball back.
Well, you see why C.J. Mosley is such a great player. Here he is right here. He's going to get fooled on this one. He's a little step behind on the coverage of the tight end. The ball goes over his head for completion. But watch the next play. He's right on it this time. Same kind of play to the other side. This time, no hesitation. He's stride for stride with Henry, gets his hands on the football, and Clinton Dix gets the interception. That's just great recovery by an All-American football player.
Alabama with a two-touchdown lead, a minute remaining in the quarter. Back to work they come with T.J. Yeldon. And Yeldon got a couple before he's brought down, and we go down to Holly.
Alabama safety Vinny Sinceri was brought to the sideline, and they did a ligament test on his left knee. I couldn't hear what they said to him, but he did not have a good reaction after they told him what they had initially found. Then they took him to the locker room. He's been taken back for further evaluation, guys, but that is certainly not good news for Alabama. I'll keep you updated as soon as we find out.
Oh, man, that isn't good news. His dad, Sal, on the Florida State coaching staff, and, of course, they've got a big one kicking off in about 10 minutes at Clemson. McCarron pumps once and incomplete, and intended for Kevin Norwood.
Threw that one away. Again, you know, A.J. McCarron, it's been so ingrained in his mind from Nick Saban as a starting quarterback, this philosophy that every possession needs to end with a kick, either an extra point, a field goal, or a punt. You know, take care of the football, play to our strengths, and he has done that beautifully during his career.
He only throws an interception about every 77. Well, there it is, passes. Second best in NCAA history. Third down and eight. McCarron has to throw in a hurry. Got it to Yeldon. Yeldon a spin move, but not enough for the first down. Nice job hanging in there by Tevin Mitchell and the Razorbacks defense, and Alabama's going to have to punt.
Really nice recovery by the Arkansas defense. After the interception, what happened to them in the second half against South Carolina last week, you wondered if they would have just kind of gone in the tank. The defense came on the field and got a big stop.
They needed that stop because right now the tide is rolling at the end of the first quarter in Tuscaloosa. Top-ranked Alabama with a 14-0 lead. The SEC on ESPN, and welcome back to Dr. Pepper's Road to the Conference Championships. Alabama trying to get to Atlanta, where the conference title will be decided. And who knows, it might be Missouri they're playing, as the SEC's been shaken up the last couple of weeks, including today, a big shakeup. Cody Mandel to punt to open up the second quarter. And Javonte Herndon, a leading receiver for Arkansas, back deep. High kick and fair catch at the last minute at about the 21-yard line. 50-yard punt. Arkansas takes over on offense. We mentioned Sal Sinceri a little bit earlier in the Florida State-Clemson matchup. There it is. Huge game in the ACC, number 5 against number 3, and two great quarterbacks. Jameis Winston, the redshirt freshman, and Taj Boyd, who's been the leader of that Clemson gang for most of his time in Clemson. And that'll be a dandy, and it's getting started in about 5 minutes on ABC.
You know, Winston has done virtually no wrong so far.
Right.
He'll be going into a different atmosphere tonight, and in a game like that, I just can't help but give the edge to the veteran guy. Taj Boyd has been a great player. He's been there, done that. I like him in that game tonight.
First down at the 21. And Alex Collins takes it off the left side where Mosley only gave him about a yard, with Ed Stinson involved in the tackle as well.
Now, this Arkansas team coming into tonight averaging 216 yards a game on the ground. They ran for over 200 yards last week against South Carolina. They only had 37 plays and they got beat 52-7, but they still ran for over 200 yards. That was the sixth running play, and they've gained a total of 2 yards so far against Alabama tonight.
The guy that comes in, the number three rusher in the SEC, Alex Collins, is finding this Alabama defense to be awfully tough to try to run on. Brandon Allen in the shotgun. Fires across the middle, in and out of the hands of Hunter Henry. A little bit high, but maybe catchable.
It's funny, you know, when we talked to Nick Saban and Kirby Smart, they both made it a point to say, you know, we're just excited. Our guys are excited. They finally get to play kind of base defense and normal football in their eyes, which
right.
is, you know, against a hard-nosed physical run team. It's not no huddle. It's not hurry up. It's let's just line up and play.
The other thing with actually huddling, that gives them time for their matchups, and that's what Nick and Kirby love to try to do defensively.
They want to try to stop you every single play. They don't want to give you an inch.
They'll try to stop a 3rd and 9 here. Allen steps up in the pocket. He's going to run for it now because he's in Neverland, and he'll come up short, 2 or 3 yards short. And Mosley in on another tackle, and Arkansas is going to have to give it back. C.J. Mosley, the captain of the defense, Theodore, Alabama, and he's the complete package. They always seem to have one or two of those guys, don't they?
You know what, if Alabama's not in a safe punt here, if they're in any kind of a normal punt return, I wouldn't be surprised to see a fake here. I mean, Arkansas has to take some gambles in the game tonight.
Sam Irwin-Hill is set to punt as you look behind him, and Christian Jones is way down there on the other end. And, boy, you called it, Todd Blackledge. Irwin-Hill's got the first down and a bunch more. Good call, partner.
Well, again, they're not going to just line up and play with Alabama. They've got to take some gambles. And as soon as Brett Bielema saw that it was a punt return team and not the first team defense for a safe punt, he went ahead and gave the green light for the fake. 4th and short. Even though it's in your part of the field, you got to take some chances if you want to beat number one in their stadium. Now, the guy that Arkansas has to get involved offensively is number four. Keon Hatcher has been a guy who's made some big plays. They like to run him on end-arounds, and he also has the ability to stretch the field with his speed.
He's to the bottom of your screen on first down for Arkansas at the 40. And
how,
the flag.
How do you not get a playoff? That's unacceptable.
Dead ball, delay of game, offense, number 10.
So just when you had things going right, you end up with a 1st and 15 on the first penalty of the ball game.
You can't afford negative plays against the number one team in the country and a team that's been as good defensively as Alabama has. You have to stay on schedule, and now you're 1st and 15.
The side judge, who is about half the size of Brett Bielema, had to push him back to the sideline. Brett was halfway out to the hash marks. And now he can afford a smile, but they don't want to get behind the sticks. Like Todd said, now 1st and 15. Not against this group. Three receivers to Brandon Allen's right. It'll be Alex Collins. And Collins runs into his own lineman, but keeps it going. And this is going to be his best run of the night. He's going to get maybe 7. Well, he's still going.
Wow. I like this guy. Now, when I've watched him on tape, he runs hard, he runs physical, he's a no-nonsense guy. He doesn't showboat, he gets up, he hands the ball to the official, and he is not afraid to stick his nose in there and run between the tackles. Guy didn't start playing football till he was a junior in high school.
He's playing pretty well now. Freshman out of Fort Lauderdale. And timeout taken by Kirby Smart and Nick Saban, and Nick Saban is hot.
Well, it's all about adjusting to the personnel groups and the formations that Arkansas likes to use. Kirby didn't like what they had.
Bradley Silve got an earful. Timeout. Traditions found a new home. The most storied conference in college athletics will live on a new network. The SEC Network launches in August 2014. For more info, go to www.getsecnetwork.com. A lot of news and notes today, mostly about upsets. And there's another one, I guess, in the brewing right now. LSU's trailing by 10.
Yeah. Matty Mock from Missouri, an Ohio guy. His brother was a really nice quarterback at Cincinnati. And Tennessee, Butch Jones, a very, very big win for him. He's done a nice job in Knoxville. They're a little short on talent, but a big win today.
And Vandy, kind of a signature win with their backup quarterback in the upset of Georgia today. Brandon Ivory made the stop on Alex Collins, a loss of a yard. And it'll bring up third down and 5.
See, what makes Alabama so difficult to run on like this is how thick and physical they are in their defensive front 7. I mean, obviously, you've got a nose tackle that's a 300-pounder, but you've got 2 defensive ends that are right around 300 pounds, mm-hmm. in Stinson and Pagan. Then you've got outside linebackers in Hubbard and Dixon and Duvall that are all 250, 260-pound guys. They are a big, physical defensive football team.
Brandon Allen in the shotgun on third down and a long 5. Fires far side, stretching out, but incomplete is the Arthur Cohen.
See, accuracy throwing the football has more to do with your feet than it does with your arm. Brandon Allen doesn't set his feet. He panics a little bit, and he doesn't get his feet set. See that footwork?
Yep.
His left foot was stepping way away from his target. You want to step right at your target and follow through. He had a man, and he had time, but his footwork got him in trouble on the bad throw.
Doubtful they'll test fate again here after faking the punt the last time. As Irwin Hill set to kick.
I see Alabama's in more of a safe punt this time. They're not going to get fooled again.
That's what I'm saying. Fool me once, but not twice. And Irwin Hill with a kick. Fair catch called for by Jones and takes it right around the 16-yard line. Just over 11 minutes remaining. First half, top-ranked Alabama by 2 touchdowns.
ESPN College Football Primetime, brought to you by Ally Bank. Your money needs an ally. And Walt Disney World Resort. Come show your Disney side.
There's the strip down on University Boulevard. I was somewhere down there last night. Now we got a little moment here. Time tonight for our
Aflac
trivia question. Who's the only quarterback in the Associated Press era to win 3 national championships? Which is what A.J. McCarron is trying to do. Got 2. 31-2 as a starter. So as I mentioned earlier, he's got as many national championship rings as he has losses in his career, the senior out of Mobile, Alabama. First down from the 16. Yeldon. Burst through, and Yeldon off to the races. Out across the 40 to the 43-yard line. Pickup of 27.
It's just a zone play, and the back has the ability to cut it back. This play's designed to go to the left, but anywhere he sees a crease, he can cut it back. There were 2 guys in 1 gap and nobody in the gap that Yeldon chose. That's just a lack of discipline on the backside of the Arkansas defense, and Yeldon made him pay for it.
And in 1 play, they go from crummy field position out to the 43-yard line. 3 wideouts for McCarron here. On a 1st and 10, but it'll be Yeldon and a counter. And this time in the middle of the pack, he picks up about 2, and we pick up Reese Davis. Reese.
Brad, Sports Center right now brought to you by Ally Bank. You mentioned this a few moments ago. Ole Miss is leading number 6 LSU 10-0. Barry Brunetti to Nick Parker for the touchdowns. Game's on ESPN2. You can use that Watch ESPN app and keep up with everything going on.
Here, 14-0 Alabama with 10 minutes remaining in the half.
Tell you, guy, Alabama is really happy with how he's developing right now. As O.J. Howard, the freshman tight end, number 88, is a guy that can stretch the field from the tight end position.
He's in there right now And McCarron over the middle. That one was low, incomplete. Amari Cooper got his hands on it, but A.J. forced that one a little too quickly.
Yeah, pretty good pressure by Arkansas. They got inside pressure, and A.J. wasn't able to set his feet and make an accurate throw, and they've got a third down and relatively long now.
Of course, the Quanjo brothers manned the left side of the line for Alabama, and A.J. just gave Cyrus, the left tackle, a couple of words about, give me another second, will you? There's the two big fellas, 310 and 315.
Arkansas shows a lot of different looks on third down. A lot of guys standing up, moving around, try to create confusion with the pass protection.
Drake came out in motion as a wide out to the bottom of your screen. McCarron, plenty of time this time, over the middle to Jones, and Jones has a first down. No problem with time to throw that time.
Coming into the game tonight, A.J. McCarron and the passing game, 127 completions, 17 different receivers. He's done a great job of spreading the football around. You know, they don't have any one guy that's dominating in the passing game, and that's, again, a tribute to two things: their depth at wide receiver and also the experience of A.J. McCarron.
And Jones, who got 9 yards on that third and eight, shaken up as he comes to the sideline. He's the sixth different guy A.J.'s used tonight. And now Drake runs into his own man. And he's got great speed down the sideline. Kenyon Drake is gone. Touchdown, Alabama. Touchdown, Alabama. 46 yards for the score for Kenyon Drake.
Well, again, this is a zone play that's supposed to go this way. He's going to look here and then cut back this way, and bad discipline on the backside of the Arkansas defense. He cuts it all the way back, a missed tackle right at the line of scrimmage, and then, as you mentioned, the speed of Drake gets it to the end zone.
Longest run allowed by Arkansas this year, capped off with Foster's extra point.
Two long runs on this drive, both the same play, one by Yeldon, one by Drake. Zone play to the left, breaks out to the backside. Poor fundamentals by Arkansas, big plays for Alabama.
Second touchdown of the night for number 17. Welcome back to ESPN's College Football Primetime, presented by Hampton Hotels. Selection committee for next year's Football Four playoff was officially announced this week. And the group, including Jeff Long, who's the committee chairman, Arkansas's athletic director, and Barry Alvarez, former Wisconsin head coach and now athletic director involved. There's the rest of the group, including Condoleezza Rice. And Jeff is here tonight, obviously, with his team, and Holly's going to be with him in a second. Cade Foster to kick now with a 21-point Alabama lead. 9 minutes remaining in the half. Fielding it at the 1 yard line is Marshall. And Marshall only got to the 10. Great job on the special teams, and a bad start for Arkansas offensively again. Let's check in with Holly.
Well, Jeff Long, the new chairperson of the playoff selection committee, and I was just curious, when they came to you with this, what were some of the factors you considered before you agreed to take on this kind of a responsibility?
Well, I had two people I wanted to talk to. First, my wife, because I knew the majority of this time would come from personal time. And then secondly, my chancellor, to make sure he was comfortable with me taking this kind of load on.
What has been the reaction to the committee that was just named on Wednesday publicly?
I think it's been overwhelmingly positive. I think it's an incredible group of people with incredible intelligence and background. So I think it's been very well received.
Now, I did hear from an inside source that at least one member of this committee has already asked if they can watch coaches' tape, not just TV copies to games. Is that something you'll make available to your people?
Well, absolutely. I don't think we can watch television copies of games and get through them all. We couldn't watch 3 hours. So, yeah, I see us having cut-ups of tape so we can get through a game very quickly.
One thing I like that you guys said this week is you're going to use a variety of parameters. It's not going to be a locked-in set formula. Why did you decide to go that route?
Well, because I think there's an incredible amount of data that's available to us. And as a committee, I think we want to look through it, make sure we're aware of what it all is, and then evaluate it and then prioritize it. And then each individual committee member will use it to the way they see the game.
What will you do this year to kind of practice and put some of these systems in place so people are knowing how to watch games or knowing what's available?
Well, we won't do anything with this year's games. Maybe this summer we may look back on this season and do some things, but out of respect for the BCS in this final year, we want to make sure that they full focus is on the BCS.
Okay, and what would a female journalist member of the media have to do when she retires to get on this selection committee? Well, I'm just asking for a friend.
I think that's a possibility.
Okay, Holly, H-O-L-L-Y.
That would be her dream
come
true.
Unless she could be an offensive line coach.
I think she would choose that over the O-line coach because she's been beating the playoff drum for as long as I've known her.
Second down and 8. Allen throwing on the run. Should have been caught by Hatcher, but it was good defense by Landon Collins back there for Alabama.
A little bit high on the throw, and Hatcher wasn't able to pull the ball in before there was contact. Yes, he got both hands on it, but if that ball's down on the numbers, then it's probably an easy catch.
Again, accuracy has been a problem for number 10 tonight, with the exception of that one seam throw to his tight end, which was perfect right over C.J. Mosley. 3 out of 8 on the night. He's missed his last 4 passes. And, of course, the one interception by Ha-Ha Clinton Dix that stopped the drive for Arkansas. Another 3rd and long. 3rd down and 8. Blitz coming. He got rid of it, and he threw a strike, and a good one to Herndon. And Herndon's got a 1st down for the Razorbacks.
Well, nice job that time. Staying in the pocket, knowing pressure was coming, trusting his offensive line to give him time, and let's see his footwork on this one. Stays in there, sets his feet, steps up, drives the ball, and gets the completion.
So they move it out to the 42-yard line. 3 wide outs with just over 7 minutes remaining in the half and trailing by 21. The Hogs have dug themselves or rutted themselves a hole against the top-ranked team in the country. Collins on a stretch play. And again, only about 3 yards. Mosley has been involved just about every time on a tackle, every time Collins touches a football.
He's such a solid football player. Smart, can run. You know, he's not as big of an inside linebacker as they've had here in the past, but he makes up for it with tremendous quickness and instincts.
He's got 6 tackles already, and we still have 6.5 minutes to go in the 1st half. And it's 2nd down and 6. Hatcher in motion will set up on a slot to the right side. And they're going to bring it to him on an end around. Hatcher's got a 1st down, so he did make an impact. Yeah. Not as a receiver, but nice hustle to get to the corner. And the sophomore, Oklahoma native, has got a 1st down.
Well, that's been a big play for them. In the South Carolina game, they opened the 3rd quarter. He ran 151 yards down to the 20-yard line and fumbled. But he has really done well on those end arounds because you have to respect the inside running game.
His 7th rush of the year. And it nets him another 1st down just inside the Alabama 47. Collins on a pitch, trying to follow his fullback, puts his head in there and got 4.
See, what Arkansas tries to do with their run game, it's kind of unique. They play 2 tight ends, 3 tight ends. They try to create an advantage in the running game, and Brett did the same thing at Wisconsin with tight ends, of trying to get an extra man or an extra blocker. So they shift, they motion, they try to get you short after you've already set your defensive front. They try to get bigger bodies on smaller bodies after you already set your defense.
The bigger bodies are to the right now, and an eye backfield behind Allen. On 2nd down and 6, and Alabama shifts. They're going to run it the other way. Collins, nothing doing there. No gain, might have lost a little bit. As we check in with Holly.
Well, you know, Brandon Allen, the quarterback from Arkansas's remarkable story. Early in the season, he got a 3rd-degree separation of his AC joint in his throwing shoulder. If you know anything about those, very painful. They thought he'd be out as many as 4 weeks, but he came back after 1 week. They've had him only practice 1 day per week leading up till this week, and this week he got all 4 days in of practice, and you see that showing here, just a little bit more effective in the passing game than he has been in previous weeks.
Yeah, he hurt that shoulder on a touchdown run that didn't look like a bad landing at all. He sort of dove into the end zone, but came up with his arm just hanging. Tonight on third and seven, he's going to try to hang one out there and does for a first down to Herndon.
Well, right there, just what Holly was talking about. There's more zip in his arm tonight than he has shown on film at any point. The ball comes out of his hands quick. He drives it right between the corner and the safety, and another big conversion on third down.
Herndon came in as their leading receiver. And a nice job there to get the foot down and pick up 22 yards.
And Arkansas has to capitalize now. They've converted some third downs, and I don't mean field goal. They got to find a way to get the ball in the end zone here and get some momentum back in this ball game.
10th play of the drive with 4 minutes to go in the half, and they're going to the end zone. And Henry, did he get it? Nope, broken up. Had his hands on it.
Yeah, but that's dangerous there. Now that, you know, after a great throw on the sideline, you don't ever want to throw the ball late or loft it down the middle unless it's single coverage without a safety. He throws this up into double coverage. He is very lucky that ball wasn't intercepted.
Collins actually had his hands on it too. And Clinton Dix was back there as well. So a battle for the football. Nobody captured it. And it's second and 10. Jonathan Williams now back in as the tailback. He's going to get the carry, and he's going nowhere. Loss of a couple. Mosley was the first there, and then he got help from his friends, including John Fulton.
Again, C.J. Mosley is the heart and soul of the defense. I mean, he reads it. Look at him. He's pointing out. He's already identifying the formation. He reads it quickly, slips inside the block of the tackle, and makes the stop behind the line of scrimmage.
Well, Todd, Brandon Allen on this drive has had a 3rd and 8 and a 3rd and 7 and picked up 20 and 22 throwing the football. Here he is, 3rd down and 11. Alabama showing blitz from the secondary, and here they come. Oh, and almost intercepted by Mosley. Allen had to get rid of it way before he wanted to, and the Alabama linebacker is the only guy that got a hand on it.
Well, C.J. Mosley's just baiting him. Watch C.J. this time. He looks like he's going to blitz, and at the last minute, he drops right into the throwing lane. He shows blitz, and then he falls right into the throwing lane and almost has an interception.
He did everything perfectly except yep. hold onto the ball.
You can't draw it up any better than that.
Zach Hocker is perfect this year with both extra points and field goals. And it's blocked. So much for perfection. Alabama still doesn't give up a point.
And the special teams of Alabama, which have been outstanding all season. They've had a punt return for a touchdown, a kickoff return for a touchdown, a blocked punt return for a touchdown, and now a blocked field goal to preserve a shutout in the first half here.
Arkansas still with a zero on the board as their kicker has one stuffed by Dion Blue. Still 21 to nothing, Alabama. Still 21 to nothing, courtesy of the blocked field goal. It was Jeff Pagan actually that got it, not Dion Blue.
Well, C.J. Mosley already forced an interception earlier. Watch him on a couple plays in a row. He's going to make a play on the run game. Reads it quickly, slips inside the block of the tackle, stopped behind the line of scrimmage. Then almost comes away with an interception. He baits the quarterback, drops right into the throwing lane and does everything but catch it. But C.J. Mosley has impacted the game in a dynamic way tonight.
No touchdowns allowed tonight, obviously, and only 77 since 2009. That's incredible. McCarron, screen pass to the star of the first half offensively, Kenyon Drake, and he's got another first down.
You know, last week when they gave up a touchdown to Kentucky, I think that was the first touchdown they've allowed since the A&M game,
yep,
right?
Yep, exactly.
Unbelievable.
They'd gone basically 4 games, and Vinny Sinceri, who's still in the locker room when he talked to us yesterday, said he mentioned a lot of the stars past of Alabama, and he said that's not how we play football defensively. It was like it was coming out of Nick's mouth
yep.
and Kirby Smart's. And so tonight they're pitching another shutout, much like they did when we were here earlier this year against Ole Miss.
Yeah, he said they had a couple bad mistakes, some mental mistakes. They had a personal foul during that scoring drive they gave up. They don't want to give up anything.
Got a player down on the Arkansas sideline. And so play stopped here with 2:46 remaining. I think it's Rohan Gaines on the far side. Sophomore out of Bainbridge, Georgia, who's down. And 2:46 remaining here, 21-0. Let's check in with Reese Davis.
All right, Brad, Buick halftime report's coming up. They started on ABC, Florida State and Clemson. They're looking at that Kelvin Benjamin catch right here. I think it looks like a touchdown that'll put the Noles up by a touchdown. Missouri is sitting pretty in the SEC, still unbeaten in conference play. Tennessee pulls a shocker. Auburn, they're in position to contend in the SEC West. LSU's in a world of trouble. Mettenberger keeps throwing it to Ole Miss. And we'll also tell you about a guy who set an NCAA single game record today, rushing yards by a quarterback. Mark and Lou are here. We'll see you in just a bit.
Now again, Rohan Gaines, left leg injury. Involved in that tackle, or at least trying to run Drake out of bounds. And I guess just got tangled up in the mess on the sideline.
Well, I think Alabama right here is going to be very aggressive. The last two games for Arkansas, they kind of battled in the first half and gave up late touchdowns. Against Florida, they gave up a 52-yard pass with 20 seconds left in the half. Against South Carolina, they gave up a short pass with 13 seconds left in the first half that really kind of took the momentum and the wind out of their sails completely.
Nice when you're playing with a 21-point lead. You can flip it out like this to DeAndre White, and White fights for 8 or 9 yards before he's taken out of bounds.
Again, here's what makes Alabama so difficult to defend right now. The offensive line is getting better. You know they're going to be able to run the football with the combination of Yeldon and Drake, and they've got a quarterback that does not put the ball in jeopardy. And they've got skill at the wide receiver and tight end position. So they're just really starting to come together offensively. They had struggles earlier in the year, but boy, here the last 3 or 4 weeks, they've looked really good.
Not struggling now. Drake back in there at tailback will get the call, and he busts into the secondary again. Kenyon Drake all the way to the 29-yard line. A 24-yard romp for the sophomore out of Powder Springs, Georgia.
Well, nice job blocking by Anthony Steen. Watch number 61 get onto the middle linebacker, stick on the block, and Drake runs right by him. Excellent block by Steen on the middle linebacker, Jarrett Lake. And then that speed and burst, again, his explosiveness to hit the hole, and when he gets into the secondary with the football.
I like his per carry average. He's got 85 yards on 6 carries and 2 touchdowns. Not a bad night. And it's not even halftime. McCarron fires far side, a little bit too far in front of Amari Cooper, incomplete.
Boy, his man had fallen down too. If he catches it, he might score.
Yeah, a little bit earlier we asked you the Aflac trivia question. Who's the only quarterback in the Associated Press era since 1936 to win 3 national championships? I have no idea. Oh, Johnny Lujack, Notre Dame. Okay, 43, 46, 47. And A.J. McCarron trying to join that group. He's off to a great start again tonight for the 6-0 top ranked Tide. Second down and 10 from the 30. With 1:14 remaining and 2 timeouts left. McCarron going deep. Man out there. Got him. Amari Cooper, touchdown.
Well, Carroll Washington was the corner, but he was expecting some help from his safety. Got no help. I'm not sure what Allen Turner, number 27, was looking at, but he didn't help his corner Washington one bit.
So McCarron put it right on him, his second touchdown pass of the night. In a near perfect first half for top-ranked Alabama. Cade Foster, the extra point is good. Amari Cooper, another one of our impact players. We told you that toe of his that's been a problem this year is getting healthy. So's the Alabama offense. 72-yard drive and 5 plays. It's 28-0. Alabama in front at home, trying to win their 11th straight game. Rohan Gaines going to the locker room and moving a little bit better than he was when he was being helped off the field. But just a minute 7 remaining first half. Keon Hatcher and Corliss Marshall again back deep. Arkansas's last 10 quarters has not been good. And number 10 will try to do something about it, but only 67 seconds to work with here before halftime. Alabama's touchdown drives 38 short field, 68, 72, and 84 yards. Running up on the kick, gonna have to hustle to get there is Marshall at about the 10-yard line and gets out across the 30. Now the chase for the Sprint Cup meets the big one at Talladega Super Speedway. Only 5 races left. Matt Kenseth and Jimmy Johnson still out front, but anything can happen at NASCAR's most unpredictable track. NASCAR Sprint Cup Series at Talladega, presented by 5-Hour Energy. It's tomorrow at 1 o'clock on ESPN. And there's how the standings look right now. And I know I've said this before, but I always wonder why the speed limit outside Talladega is about 50 miles an hour when you're driving through there, but you can go 200 miles right. an hour yeah. when you get there. Doesn't make any sense to me.
At least let us bust it up to 70.
Yeah, yeah. Know? That's a ticket waiting to happen. Collins going the wrong way, unless he can find some blocking. Now cuts it up, and that's a tough run to get 2 yards. But he did get something out of nothing.
Mentioned that Alex Collins didn't play football to his junior year, played basketball, lacrosse, track, and also, get this, competitive cheerleading.
He'd be a monster schooler. Of a cheerleader.
Wow.
Allen looking to throw on the run, and he's got to throw it away. Hunter Henry was the closest guy, tight end. So down to 27 seconds. Brett Bielema is going to have to regroup his troops at halftime. And again, Todd talked about it in the open. He was not happy with his team's second half performance against South Carolina, where he thought that they sort of gave in for the first time. And he let them know that Sunday after that 52-7 loss. And now here at halftime, they're going to be down 28 more points, it appears, unless something big happens in the final 27 seconds. Williams on 3rd and 8, and he's going to be short of the first down. Alabama's got 2 timeouts left. Let's see if they're going to use one. They're going to be content with yeah. a 28-point lead at halftime as the clock will run down. AJ McCarron, you can smile when you're up 28-0. You've always thrown a couple of touchdown passes for the number one team in the country. Big first half for Alabama. Two McCarron touchdown passes, 2 Kenyon Drake touchdown runs, 28-0 as we go to Holly and Nick.
Well, Coach, you were concerned about their rushing attack. You've held them to just a little bit over 60 yards in the first half. What's been the key to that?
Well, you know, we got to tackle a little bit better. We got to clean them up a little bit better. I think we've had good leverage on the ball, but, you know, the guys are good backs, man, and they're making us miss, and we just got to do a better job of tackling.
This season, you've had to shuffle your secondary quite a bit. I just saw Bradley Silv go to the locker room and also Vinny Censeri. How will shuffling affect you in the second half again?
Well, we really had to shuffle it up. You know, Ha-Ha had to go in and play. It's good that we have him back. But I think everybody's playing in a position now that they're comfortable with. So it'll be good for us to be able to go over some of the things they did in the first half and get the adjustments right.
Thanks, Coach.
All right, thank you.
Well, in Nick's mind, it wasn't perfection, but from up here, it looked pretty darn good. Halftime, 28-0 as we send it to Reese and the guys for the Buick Halftime Report. You're watching the SEC on ESPN.
It would be 11 straight wins for the Crimson Tide of Alabama if they can pull it off at Bryant-Denny Stadium tonight.
Play fake. McCarron just floats it out wide open. That was just too easy. And now Drake runs into his own man. And he's got great speed down the sideline. Kenyon Drake is gone. Touchdown, Alabama. McCarron going deep. Man out there. Got it. Amari Cooper, touchdown. In a near-perfect first half for top-ranked Alabama. And we welcome you back to ESPN's College Football Primetime presented by Hampton Hotels. All Alabama in the first half. 28-0, just about set to start the third quarter. We welcome you back to Tuscaloosa, everybody. Brad Nessler and Todd Blackledge going to the locker room. You know, Nick told Holly, we got to clean some things up.
Yeah.
He plays for perfection. That's why he's won three national titles, yeah, and they were almost perfect in the first half.
They were brilliant in all three phases. They controlled the football game. Ironically, Arkansas ran two more plays than Alabama in the first half, but Alabama gained 133 more yards and more big plays. So both coaches are talking at halftime and telling them, look, let's play this game like it's 0-0, but for different reasons. Alabama to finish, to continue trending forward. Arkansas, let's get something to build on as we go forward in this season.
Alabama first half, no turnovers, no penalties, no sacks allowed, and they scored on four of their five possessions. Kickoff goes to the six-yard line of Keon Hatcher. And Hatcher got a little bit of a crease, but he lost the ball. The tide takes over on the opening play of the third quarter.
Well, all phases. The special teams this year for Alabama have been dominant from start to finish. They started the opening game of the year with a kickoff return and a punt return for touchdowns, and they've continued to play at a very high level. And they caused a turnover on the opening kickoff of the second half.
Derrick Henry ripped the ball out of there. Alabama covers it. Eddie Jackson, a couple of freshmen on the special teams. And here's the tied offense, one play into the third quarter at the 30-yard line of the Razorbacks. And McCarron on the roll, throws back across his body to Christian Jones. And Jones gets about 9 yards on the catch.
McCarron is now 13 for 17. He's made 8 of his completions to wide receivers and 5 to running backs. Spreading the ball around, the only guy that hasn't gotten a piece of the pie is the tight end position.
So where's Vogler?
Yeah, or O.J. Howard.
Right. Second down, a long yard in the pistol set. T.J. Yeldon hasn't gotten the scoring act yet tonight. Drake, though, has his backup, who's got a couple of touchdowns. And here is T.J. And he's got a first down. Let's check in with Holly Rowe.
Well, guys, I spoke with Brett Bielema of Arkansas at the half, and he said, we're just not doing anything to win this football game right now. He said, we're looking forward to a good offensive position on this kickoff and get some momentum. Well, then they turn it over. They needed that momentum that they had gained in that last drive before the half. He said, we finally found a way to run the football. That's what we need to build on. But, of course, the devastating turnover, and oh, boy.
Yeah, oh, boy is right. First 5 minutes of the third quarter are always important, especially when you get the second half kickoff, but you don't give it back to the top-ranked team in the land where they are right now, back in the red zone. And a first down inside the 17. McCarron all day to throw. Crossing route, there's O.J. Howard. Touchdown. And now he's got a piece of the pie. And the route is on. Just a minute and a half into the third quarter. McCarron's third touchdown pass of the Knights. Extra point up and good. Just over 90 seconds into the third quarter. A fumbled kickoff, and then the master, McCarron, goes to work to the guy that Todd was calling for, the freshman tight end. 17 yards, 35-0. As we take a look at our good hands play brought to you by Allstate, good route, good throw, good hands. Todd.
Yep, and a good read by A.J. McCarron, just crossing routes. You've got Vogler crossing, you've got Kenny Bell crossing, and then the guy he goes to right here, O.J. Howard, on the shallow cross. He's a talented young player, a freshman tight end, can really stretch the defense, and he gets his first touchdown in what's going to be a very promising career as an Alabama tight end. Easy read for A.J. McCarron and an easy throw and catch for the touchdown.
He's had about everybody on that sideline come on and congratulate him on that first touchdown in a tied uniform. From a yard deep, Corliss Marshall on the return, and he's not going to make it to the 20 again. Great coverage on the special teams, Landon Collins. Alabama trying to win a third straight national title. And you talk about three-peats, the UConn women, the L.A. Lakers with Kobe Bryant and company, the Yankees, 98 to 2000, the Islanders, 80 to 83. And John Wooden's great team, Walt Hazard there, 67 to 73. And then way back, the Golden Gophers of Minnesota, 34 to 36. And these guys are on the path right now. Still a lot of season left, but they're rolling along, about to be 7-0 unless Arkansas can do something about it here in the next two quarters. Allen with a little roll to the left, and the throw is on target to Henry. His tight end, first down. Well, you might get him. Speaking of LSU, we now hear they're trailing 17 to nothing.
Wow.
It looks like this might be upset Saturday in the SEC, with the exception of what we're watching. So after the first down, better field position, 30-yard line. Herndon in motion, sets up in the slot right. Allen's going to have to throw this one away. Whatever that was, it blew up in a hurry, courtesy of the Alabama defense.
Well, he was trying to get the ball, I think, quickly to his fullback, Hero Small, out of the backfield. Wasn't there, decided to leave the pocket again. Alabama pretty locked in on this offense. And, you know, I mentioned that special teams, the little hidden yardage. Arkansas starting average field position tonight, their own 21-yard line.
Yeah.
When you want to go against this kind of a defense, you need some short fields in there. They have not had it all night.
Second down and 10. Draw play to Williams. And he got two or three before C.J. Mosley closed the door again. Boy, number 32 has been all over the field again tonight.
Just to follow up on that special teams, I think why Alabama has been so good, not just this year, but in years past. First of all, Bobby Williams, one of the assistants, that's his specialty. He works the special teams for Alabama. But also, because they've recruited so well, they've got backup guys that are eventual starters that are playing on their special teams. They've got high-quality talent on all their coverage teams.
Third down and 7. Again, he's going to roll and try to throw back across his body, and does. Second time in this drive, he's kept it going. And this one's Javonte Herndon for the first down. Pick up a 14. Oh, he dropped the ball. Incomplete. So they're going to have to punt it away. Eighth time tonight that Arkansas has had a third down and 7 or longer. And that's one thing that Brett Bielema and Jim Chaney, the offensive coordinator, talked with us about. We can't get behind on the sticks, and they've been behind the sticks and the eight ball all night long. Irwin Hill set to punt. Short, wobbly kick. We're going to have to let this one bounce. And it takes an Alabama roll, as everything seems to have rolled Alabama's way tonight so far. A.J. McCarron just about got hit by the official. Other than that, three touchdown pass night. He's going back to work in a minute.
ESPN College Football Primetime, brought to you by Verizon. Never be without football. Call Star NFL to download NFL Mobile from Verizon. And the new action thriller Escape Plan, now playing in theaters.
Welcome back to Dr. Pepper's Road to the Conference Championships. Alabama heading that way, 35 to nothing. They lead as we check in with Holly.
Well, guys, Vinny Sanceri of Alabama came out of the locker room without his shoulder pads on. He's in sweats. There is a big, bulky knee brace on that left knee. I've seen him walking along the sidelines, kind of getting hugs from guys. They won't update me on what his condition is. Obviously, he won't return in this game, but hopefully he is not out for long, guys. He's such a big part of this team. He's getting a lot of hugs and support from his teammates.
Yeah, he is. He's a special player. DJ Yeldon brought down by Filan before he got to the first down, but he did get 7. So TJ, not the kind of night that Kenyon Drake has had so far, but he hasn't had as many opportunities either.
And again, they're different kind of runners. Yeldon is a little more physical, a little bigger, maybe a little bit better between the tackles and breaking tackles. Drake is more explosive. and a little faster with the ball in his hands.
He had a 46-yard touchdown run where he showed the speed. TJ right now 10 carries for 59 yards, and he's in the pistol behind McCarron on second down and three. He'll get the call again, wraps both arms around the ball and picks up the first down at the 40.
You see, what we'll probably see here now is a play action pass from Alabama on first down. Their offensive line has not given up a sack in the last 11 quarters, going back to the Ole Miss game.
The game we did here, yeah.
And part of that is because they throw mostly out of play action right now. They only have had 4 third down plays in the game tonight. They've converted 3 of them. They're throwing on early downs off of play action, and that just makes it a lot easier to protect the quarterback.
They've only been sacked, AJ has, 7 times this year, and this is game 7. He will throw, and he's going to throw short, check down route to Yeldon, and Yeldon broke a tackle, and he picks up about 15 before the crashing ending on the Alabama sideline.
I think Yeldon is a little more valuable in the passing game than Drake right now, only because he's more familiar with the pass protection and the blitz pickups, and then he can break tackles. Again, we talked about a little stronger, a little more physical. Watch him break the one-man tackle here. That's not a defensive back either. That's a linebacker, Braylon Mitchell. He just runs right through the would-be tackler.
Nice stiff arm to get up and pick up 17 yards to the 43. Here comes your play action, Todd. McCarron, plenty of time, directing traffic. Now he's got to get rid of it as the pressure finally did get to him.
Yeah, they took a shot, looking for a deep route. Wasn't there. Don't force a bad mistake. You know, give the defense credit. They made a pretty good job covering, even though Cooper might have been open.
At that time, though, McCarron's running the other way.
Yep. Second and 10 is better than second and 20 or an interception and first down for the other guys.
Nobody knows that better than that guy. Now at second and 10, the stretch play to Drake. Already got the corner. Now the cutback. And Drake down close to another first down. Picks up 9 more. Eric Bennett finally brought him down.
Last week against Kentucky, this Alabama offense had the second greatest output in the last 40 years, 668 yards of offense, and they were scoreless in the first quarter, mainly because Drake had a fumble, Yeldon had a fumble deep in Kentucky territory, and they had about a half a dozen drop passes. But other than that, the offense was virtually unstoppable last week, as it has been again tonight.
158 between the two of them, the two-headed tailback monster for Alabama, including 2 touchdowns by Yeldon, by Drake, rather. Third down and 1 here. Delayed handoff, but he got it in his gut, and he's got the first down and a bunch more. Down to the 25-yard line. Alabama, their leaders tonight. McCarron, obviously, with a great night. 3 touchdowns on a 15 for 20. Drake over 100 yards. And Amari Cooper, the guys that we said would be impact players, and they have been.
Yeah. And really, for Cooper, back-to-back games where he is involved in the offense. Again, healthier than he's been at any point in the year. Coming into tonight, only 12 catches on the season.
Empty backfield now as Yeldon comes out as an extra wide receiver. And timeout taken by Arkansas. Not even sure if they had enough guys out there. At any rate, 8:34 remaining third quarter. All Alabama right now.
Visit WatchESPN.com or download the Watch ESPN app to watch ESPN live anytime, anywhere. Brought to you by Vizio.
Brad Nessler, Todd Blackledge, Holly Rowe. Back in Tuscaloosa, 35-0 Alabama. Arkansas used a timeout there, and upon further review, they were a man short defensively. Thus the timeout to try to prevent any further damage.
Yeah, they've had enough trouble going 11-on-11.
That's right. They could use 12 the way Alabama's playing tonight. It's Hyde with another first down at the Hogs 24. A.J. McCarron, for the most part tonight, the ones he didn't complete, he threw away on purpose. Four wide receivers for him, three to his left. He's looking that way, and now comes back the other way to the corner, and what a catch by T.J. Yeldon.
Oh, dropped it at the end, but what an effort. You know, he dropped a sure touchdown last week against Kentucky. This was a tremendous effort and just couldn't secure it all the way to the ground.
Lost it on landing.
Nice throw, tremendous effort. Couldn't hold on.
So second down and 10. And again, that'll be an incompletion, but a near perfect throw by McCarron again. Draw play. Yeldon straight up the middle. He might get it on the ground instead of through the air. Touchdown, Alabama. And he's got a piece of the pie. What a run. Great stiff arm again. Broken tackle. Headed to the corner. 24-yard touchdown. Yeldon. Cade Foster's been a busy kicker tonight, just knocking through extra points. Another long Alabama scoring drive. T.J. Yeldon. Been the only guy of the superstars not to find the end zone until this play to cap a 72-yard drive in 8 plays. 42-0 Crimson Tide. The SEC on ESPN. And right now the Tide just twirling past the Razorbacks of Arkansas 42-0.
I want to go back to this touch. I want you to see two guys. Number one, we talked about the new center. Chad Lindsey's been in ever since the Ole Miss game. Watch him get his block. And then once Yeldon gets into the secondary, take a look right here. Amari Cooper blocking downfield, a wide receiver in the second level. Starts at the line of scrimmage, finishes at the second level, and Yeldon gets a little piece of that apple pie.
Adam Griffith to kick off. Gonna give Kate Foster's leg a breather. Marshall and Hawkins back deep. And he got all of this one. And he'll take a knee. And we'll have a moment to check in with Reese Davis. Reese.
Brad, time for Sports Center right now, brought to you by Ally Bank. Couple of games, one going on in ESPN2. LSU's finally on the board. Kenny Hilliard, they called that a touchdown. And a couple more plays probably would have gotten it anyway. 17-7, number six is trailing to Ole Miss in Oxford. On ABC, Florida State leading Clemson 17-7. The Tigers scored a touchdown. And Bashaud Breeland picked off Jameis Winston. That didn't result in a score. A lot of time left in the second quarter there.
All right, Reese, here, all Alabama. As Collins on the handoff fights for 5 yards with Trey DePriest draped all over him.
I really do think this kid has a bright future if he stays healthy. I love the way he hits it up in there hard. Physical guy.
When he was recruited, his mom wasn't crazy about the fact that he was going to go to Fayetteville. Yeah. And the papers had to be signed for Brett Bielema that officially have him as his, I guess, top recruit. But dad got involved. And I think Alex is pretty comfortable in Fayetteville, and they're pretty happy to have him. End around. And not going to get a first down. Only get about a yard on it. Jeremy Sprinkle as we check in with Holly.
Well, I checked in with some of the Arkansas folks, though, and they said that Alex's mom, Andrea, has come up to a game in Fayetteville. She came to the Florida game. They live down in Miami, so things are good. She's supporting her son at Arkansas. But as a mother who just sent a son to college, I totally get where she's coming from. It is hard.
Yeah, she would rather he had stayed in state so she could travel a few miles less.
Well, Holly's son is in state, but the problem is she is very seldom in state because of how hard she works.
True. Third down and 3. This play's been successful tonight, rolling to his left and throwing to his tight end, and it works again for a first down for Brandon Allen to Hunter Henry.
You look at this Arkansas team, and again, it's a work in progress. As you see Allen get his shoulders around nicely and an accurate throw, good mechanics, good footwork. But you've got two freshmen starting at offensive guard. You got a freshman in Collins, who we talked about, and that freshman who caught that ball, Hunter Henry. That's four freshmen playing significantly in your starting offense, and a sophomore quarterback.
Kiero Small, a fullback in there, trying to get a block for Allen. He's just got to whip this thing as far as he can to get rid of it. Williams was on the blitz, and he got around Kiero Small.
Well, one of the things that Brandon Allen will get better at the more he plays is just pocket awareness. That time, if he just steps up and allows Kiero Small to block that outside defender past the pocket, he probably has a chance to make a play. He leaves the pocket a little bit sooner than he needs to right now, and a lot of that just comes from inexperience.
Collins, number three, back in there at tailback on second and 10.
They got Henry lined up as a fullback here.
Here's a pitch to Collins, trying to get to the edge, looking for a block from his wide receiver. Didn't get much of one. And Williams made the tackle. Drew Morgan, another freshman wide receiver out there, trying to get a piece of somebody.
Well, they tried to fool him by formation by putting Henry in the fullback, thinking that they would get the defense looking for pass to try to get Collins out to the edge. And again, this Alabama defense, I mean, they don't get fooled very often.
Nope.
Whether it's starters in there or backups, they're on it pretty good.
There's a guy that's a ringleader making the call, C.J. Mosley. Third down and 7. Again, they roll left and throw. And this one's intercepted. Picked off. And it's Cyrus Jones this time.
You know, again, you make a play on him, and then you try to go to that same type of play or action, and it doesn't work two times in a row. Cyrus Jones broke on the ball and broke out of the route before the receiver did. He read it, and he broke on the football before the receiver came out of his route.
And his head coach
unbelievable
leaps on his cornerback, who gets the interception. Well, we might have seen the last of A.J. McCarron in a 42-0 game. Blake Sims is in at quarterback. Junior out of Gainesville, Georgia, at the controls and in the shotgun. Gives it off to Jalston Fowler, and Fowler got a couple as we check in with Holly.
Nick Saban told us yesterday that he doesn't believe in running up the score, so it'll be interesting to see what he does here with 42-0 lead. He has put in some of his second string offensive line. I see Kellen Williams in there, Grant Hill coming in. So just interesting to see how he's trying to piece together a few second string guys here while still trying to keep some momentum.
If McCarron's done for the night, you just saw his numbers, and that quarterback rating will be pretty high.
Yeah.
Second down and 8. Again, Fowler stays in there. Sims on the throw, incomplete, intended for Vogler, the tight end. And it brings up third down and 8.
You still want to give this guy some real plays, Blake Sims. I mean, he's more known as a dual threat guy than A.J. McCarron, but you want him to throw the ball a little bit in game situations. You never know, as you go down the road, something happens to A.J. McCarron and this is your guy.
Yeah.
You want him to be comfortable in all aspects of your offense.
Alabama, their 6 third downs, 3 of them have been 3rd and 1. This is a long one here, 3rd down and 8.
And the one threat he poses is a runner if it breaks down.
Hogs show blitz, they bring blitz. Sims has to scramble and throw it away. Now, good pressure. Allen Turner came on the safety blitz, and he got in there to raise some havoc in the backfield.
Yeah, Chris asked, you know what, new quarterback, we're bringing the house.
Why not?
Yep. A.J. McCarron, not so much. Blake Sims, we're going to go after him.
So Cody Mandel hasn't been very busy tonight, but he's set to punt here, and they're a man short, I think, on their punt team. Here comes Fowler running out to give him that three-man protection. Javonte Herndon is the guy that's back deep. Oh, almost had it blocked, and they run into the kicker, and the flags are down as the punt rolls down around the goal line. But again,
Wow.
DJ Dean is the guy I think that is going to have a roughing the punter penalty.
Defense number one. The penalty is 15 yards from the previous spot and includes an automatic first down.
They draw the penalty and they down it inside the one. DJ Dean comes right up the middle, but you got to peel off. You can't continue on that same line. You got to pick a side, go to the side of the kicking foot and try to take it off from the side.
There was no doubt about that one. Yeah. That's an easy call. Just a matter of when the flag's coming out of the official's pocket. So automatic first down, and back out comes Blake Sims at quarterback. Rough night for Brett Bielema. Right now, nothing's going right. No turnovers, no penalties, no sacks, all offense, scoring on virtually every drive. And they're continuing to drive, and it's Fowler. A head-on collision with Turner. And a pickup of five as we check in with Reese.
Rev, want to show you tremendous punt return. Baylor is destroying Iowa State. Levi Norwood's going to run all over the lot. Now, with other teams falling in front of Baylor and the Bears continuing to put up Xbox-like EA Sports numbers, what do you do with Baylor now? 51-0, going to the fourth quarter. Great punt return by Norwood.
Well, when you say that a team's lowest output of the year is 35, it's a lot of offense that Baylor's got going right there. Second down and five. Sims under center. And it's Fowler. And he's met head on by Austin Jones. No gain on that one. As we're down to 3:45 remaining in the third quarter. And again, Alabama with a 42-0 lead, playing some of their second line guys. Some of those second line guys could play for a whole bunch of teams as starters around the country.
And that again is why they're so good on special teams, because a lot of those backup receivers, linebackers, defensive backs that were five-star type recruits are on all the special teams.
Bell and Cooper and Black are all in there, wide receiver, the starters. And this one is tipped and almost intercepted. It was intended for Amari Cooper and Rohan Gaines and Carroll Washington back there defending.
That wasn't a bad throw that time by Blake Sims. He set his feet, threw the slant. Washington actually just made a nice play on the ball.
So field goal time for Alabama. It's been all touchdowns to this point. Cade Foster, 7 out of 8 on the year with a long of 53. So this is well within his range. It'll be a 48-yard field goal attempt. Foster, a senior out of Southlake, Texas. Been a busy extra point kicker, but here's his first field goal attempt of the night. And it is perfect. Three more for Alabama. Remember, roughing the punter penalty cost Arkansas probably that 3 points right there. 45-0, a little over 3 minutes remaining in the third quarter. Just a taste of what the number one team in the country can do. And speaking of taste, let's check in with Todd's Taste of the Town.
Having done 5 Taste of the Towns in Tuscaloosa already, I decided to do something different. So I came over to the quad to visit a tailgate. Now, I had a lot to choose from, all the way from traditional hamburgers and hot dogs to a lively group from Birmingham with a full Italian feast. But with Arkansas in town, I decided I needed to do something pig-related. And I found exactly what I wanted at the tailgate of Mike and Bonnie Corbett. The Corbetts have been doing this since 2000, and what Mike's working today are some ribs and 3 smoked pork butts. Add to that his signature item, the grilled bacon wrapped chicken jalapeno poppers, an assortment of side dishes and homemade desserts, and man, I am ready to settle in. Now, the game starts at 6:15. Tell Ness I'll be there about 6.
I'm glad you showed up, partner. I wasn't with you on that. But you told me an interesting note about pork butt. A lot of people have called me a pork butt in the past, but a little known fact.
Pork butt is not the butt of a pig. It's actually from the front shoulder. I didn't know that. I learned that.
Right about there?
Yeah. Use the left shoulder, not the throwing shoulder. But that's where pork butt comes from. And we had that. And then I actually went to the Italian tailgate also. I had to eat 2 full plates You know, that's disrespectful to go to a tailgate and not eat a plate of food.
Well, when you called me, I thought you were in maybe the emergency room or whatever. I'm actually on the treadmill when Todd called me.
Yeah.
And you could barely talk or breathe.
Yeah, see, that's the Italian tailgate. So that was the second time. And when I got from there back to the hotel, I was having a few problems.
Oh, yeah, you were weakened. Yeah. Even your voice was weakened.
But I have rebounded and recovered. And
you're hungry now.
May visit that after the game. Because apparently, both of those tailgates are still going strong when the game ends.
I'm sure they will be. So Arkansas down 45-0 now here late in the third quarter. After just a 23-yard drive and seven plays for Alabama to get the field goal. This is just a no fun place to be in if you're a Razorback fan. Collins, a tough couple of yards.
Right now, you're just looking for anything. And this game, I think, even though score-wise you might say same thing as last week, it feels different to me. When I watched that game on tape against South Carolina, they lost some guys. They had some guys that weren't given everything they had. I don't see that tonight. I just think Alabama is an outstanding team that is getting better and better each time out. And Arkansas has had a difficult time getting much of anything going.
You know, when it was 3-0 for Alabama at the beginning of the year, people were saying, yeah, but I don't think they're saying that anymore.
Nope.
Collins, nice cutback. And trying to get to the edge and stumbles on his own, and he's still only going to get about 3 yards out of it. You talk about teams hungry for a win. How about Monday Night Football? Adrian Peterson and the Vikings battling Eli Manning and the Giants at MetLife. Coverage starts with Monday Night Countdown at 6:30. And it's the Vikes and the Giants. 8:25 on ESPN and live on Watch ESPN. Two teams desperately in need of a win. Third down again. We've said that about 100 times tonight for Arkansas. Third down at 5. And they've converted 5 of 12. Not this time. Well, maybe. Allen got away. Nifty footwork in the pocket, and he does get the first down, and he pays for it at the end of the run. As Dylan Lee let him have it, but he did get the first down.
Well, Brandon Allen, and again, this is what you want to see if you're Arkansas. Are our guys going to keep fighting, keep competing? Are they going to mail it in here in the fourth quarter? And Brandon Allen is not mailing it in. He's fighting. He's competing. He's getting away from some sacks and takes a hit at the end, but gets a first down. Well, Brandon has a younger brother, Austin, that is also a quarterback on the football team, was part of the 2013 recruiting class. And their dad is works in the department, director of
high school and NFL.
Yep. Yep.
Here's a good run, and that's going to be Williams, who should have another first down. With more on Arkansas, here's Holly.
Well, tonight not going how they planned, but Brett Bielema is trying to change the culture there at Arkansas, and he's doing it in kind of a tough love way. They had a third string tight end who was late 5 minutes to the special teams meeting this week. They left him home. He wants it done the right way.
Yeah, Brett definitely does things on task like that and discipline, and another good run by Williams. 100th game coaching for Brett Bielema. 71 of those have been wins. Tonight's not going to be one of them.
He was calling for a horse collar there, I think.
It was close.
Yeah.
Second down, a long yard. Alex Collins back in there as a tailback in the eye behind Kiero Small. And he'll get the pitch, trying to follow Small. Now he takes it outside instead, and it's a good choice. Ha-ha, Clinton Dix knocked him out of bounds, but he got the first down. And now the other coach giving the linesman an earful.
I'll tell you what I like about Alex Collins. And I noticed this on film right away. You know, tonight's a frustrating night. He's not gaining a lot of yards. He's getting hit and knocked all around. Watch what he does at the end of the play. He does this every time on film. Frustrating night, gets what he can. After the play, gets up, and he's just going to go and hand the ball to the official. And he does that every time. And that shows me something about the kid, his maturity, all business playing the game.
Alabama all business tonight. Number one team in the country, 15 minutes away from being 7-0 on the year. Alamo storied conference in college athletics will live on a new network tradition, finding a new home as the SEC Network launches in August 2014. For more info, go to www.getsecnetwork.com. Some of the SEC teams in the top 25 took it on the chin today. A&M, South Carolina, Florida, and Georgia all losing. And right now, LSU's on the short end to Ole Miss.
And I think the biggest surprise in there is Missouri. They lost their starting quarterback, James Franklin. A lot of people didn't think they'd be able to handle Florida at home.
Matty Mock did a good job.
And I think they've got about a two-game lead now in the East.
They do. Brandon Allen, nice play fake, and on the bootleg, he's still got to throw it away. Nobody open. So the only thing that's not going haywire in the SEC as far as the teams that everybody expected to win is what we're watching right here.
You know, it's interesting. I ran into Eli Gould earlier, and he was saying that, you know, when you look back at Alabama, the 2010 team, that they were very talented, but they didn't seem to get better week in and week out. And this team got better. There's Eli, the longtime voice of Alabama football. This team is so much better than they were earlier in the year, and even when we saw them 3 weeks ago against Ole Miss.
Yep. And that was a shutout. And this one is as well. Timeout.
Timeout. Arkansas.
14:50 remaining in the ball game. Nick Saban en route to yet another win here for the Crimson Tide. The SEC on ESPN from Tuscaloosa as we welcome you back to Dr. Pepper's Road to the conference championship. Alabama heading in that direction. Looks like they might be heading to Georgia Dome again this year. They are certainly the front runners in the SEC West right now, just cruising tonight, able to use some of their second line players with A.J. McCarron and some of the starters done for the night in a 45-0 game. Kiero Small in the backfield. Other than that, it's Brandon Allen to throw. Pumps one way and goes deep the other. And I don't know, Hunter Henry just, I don't know if he gave up on that or if he lost it. Looked like he didn't keep running down there on the pattern. Incomplete at any rate.
Well, he had his man beat. The ball thrown over the wrong shoulder, I think, is all that it was.
Yep.
Anderson was in coverage, and Hunter was expecting that ball thrown to his inside instead of over the outside shoulder.
The Razorbacks, the deepest they've gotten into Alabama territory tonight is the 22-yard line. So you talk about a stingy defense. And here's another third down and 10 situation. Low snap. Allen has to one-hand it. Now he's running for his life and just has to throw it in a hurry. Diving attempt. Was it caught? It was by Drew Morgan.
Boy, nice effort by quarterback and receiver. This will probably get looked at again, but nonetheless, getting away from the blitz. Dylan Lee was in there creating the pressure.
And Arkansas losing one of their offensive linemen on the play. Gigantic left guard freshman Dan Skipper helped off the field. 6'10", 317 pounds. I've never seen a guard that big. Or that tall, anyway.
And he's athletic, and he can bend. Again, he and the other guard, Denver Kirkland, both bright, bright futures.
Scott Johnson, our illustrious director, just pointed out to me, I've never seen a guard that big. He said, how about Magic Johnson? That's close. Fourth down, and the punt coming from Sam Irwin Hill. End over end kick. Nice fake job to get out of the way, but it's saved. Nice job on the special teams around the 1 yard line. Good hustle by Arkansas. Good punt by Irwin Hill. Alabama in a hole, but not on the scoreboard when we come back.
ESPN College Football Primetime is presented by Hampton Hotels. Feel the Hamptonality. And in part by GMC. Visit your local GMC dealer to see why incredible thinking is everywhere.
Alabama leading 45-0. Their offense is at the 1 yard line after that great punt coverage. You think any of the defenders for Alabama said, guys, don't get a safety here? There would be the end of our shutout. And DeHart, he gets a couple little more room to work as Carroll Washington made the tackle. And we check in with Reese Davis. Reese.
All right, Brad, we'll get you up to date on Florida State and Clemson. Clemson brings his zone blitz and Jameis Winston, and he makes him pay. Rashad Greene makes Rashad Breeland miss. Gone. Takes it to the house, and LaMarcus Joyner just intercepted a pass. That's to go with the two fumbles he's forced, one of which was returned for a touchdown. 24-7 Noles.
Here it's Blake Sims, the quarterback for Alabama. And DeHart, the tailback, still set up about 4 yards deep in the end zone.
Alabama called a timeout from the sideline. Nick Saban called that.
Timeout, Alabama. First timeout this half. This will be a 30-second timeout.
Nick in his seventh year here. Four national titles, including the one at LSU. Sunday NFL countdowns. Way to get your NFL Sunday start at 10 o'clock tomorrow. Chris Berman and all the guys with the latest news and updates from around the league. Ray Lewis sits down with Rex Ryan and talks about the Patriots-Jets showdown. And on ESPN 2 at 11, you can catch Fantasy Football Now for the latest news, injury reports, and predictions for the top fantasy performers. All tomorrow morning on ESPN and ESPN 2.
You know, the thing I really like about this Alabama offense, and now, of course, we have all backups in now, but where they're at, first of all, I love their balance, the run-pass balance. And I love that they can go both under the center and run their offense,
right,
and also out of the shotgun or the pistol. They've got great diversity. Doug Nussmeier does a nice job as their offensive coordinator, play caller. Mario Cristobal, their new offensive line coach, they did, you know, they didn't panic when the offensive line wasn't getting it done early and they had negative plays. They stayed the course. They kept working. Kept working on their communication up front, and it's paying off right now.
And now they got their third-string tailback in there, and he just rips off a long run. And now they're bringing in their fourth-string tailback, Derrick Henry. You talk about the balance you were talking about, Ledge. That run just broke up the perfect balance. 25 runs, 24 passes tonight.
Last year in their national championship season, they ran the ball for 3,185 yards and passed it for 3,052 yards. 133 yards difference, and that's balance.
And now they got their bruiser in there at tailback, the true freshman. Henry is 6'3", 238, so he's a whole different package. And again, there are two main ingredients at tailback, T.J. Yeldon and Kenyon Drake. Both had huge nights, including Drake going over 100 yards for two touchdowns. Yeldon, 88 yards on 12 carries and a touchdown. Nice feeling when you're at home and you can just hang on the sideline and watch the other guys that don't get a lot of work go to work. And here's Blake Sims doing what he does really well. Picks up the first down on the ground.
Well, this is the dimension that Blake Sims gives you as a dual threat guy. It's a little play action pass. He's got a run pass option. He doesn't like what he sees, and he uses his strength, his wheels. Gets the first down, moves the sticks, new set of downs.
Got a big block out there from the third string tight end as well. There's the balance in the last 4 years. That's amazing. Henry, nice cutback for the big guy. And he's got a first down and a lot more, and they're having a hard time getting him on the ground. Into Arkansas territory, a 21-point rumble.
I was here to do the spring game this year, and they were really high on this guy, but he got hurt early in the spring and missed a good portion of that. Very talented guy, a lot of yardage. Has a high school career in Florida. Big physical guy, as you mentioned.
21 yards on the carry before they can bring down number 27. Five straight runs, including the one by the quarterback for Alabama right now. And for Arkansas, they kind of wish this was a running clock about now, I think. Again, strength, the 238-pounder to go. Five more. Filon picked up the tackle.
You know, you talk about what Alabama has done and what Nick Saban has done here in the last few years, and you use that word dynasty, and it's an appropriate word in a day and age when it's supposed to be parity with the limited scholarship numbers, and you shouldn't be able to do what they've done, attempting to win three national championships in a row, four in the last 5 years.
The next best Alabama teams to do that, when Bear Bryant was here, they won three titles, but it was a five-year span from 61 to 65. Yeah. So no matter how you slice it, if they get back in that game and win it again, this is the cream of the crop maybe of all time.
And it all starts with recruiting, and that's where Nick Saban is as good as there is, and a relentless recruiter and talent evaluator. And where that shows up is not just winning championships, it shows up also in draft picks and who they put into the NFL. And over the last 4 years, they put more players, 29 draft picks, more than any other school in the last 4 years, and 13 of those guys have been first round picks. So, I mean, they recruit great high school talent, they develop them more here, they win championships, and then they send them to the NFL.
Yep. This will be their 68th win since 2008 as D. Hart goes for another first down run. And he sprints across the first down line, and the chase for the Sprint Cup will be at Talladega Super Speedway tomorrow at 1 o'clock on ESPN. Only five races left. Kenseth and Jimmy Johnson still out in front, but anything can happen on that track. That comes your way tomorrow, 1 o'clock on ESPN. This has been a little bit like a Sprint Cup night, but only one car is going around the track.
You know, and the tough thing for Arkansas is it doesn't slow down yet. I mean, they've got Auburn next, right?
Yeah. And Auburn, a winner today over Texas A&M. Sims run all the way for the quarterback inside the 30 before DeMarcus Hodge made the tackle. There'll be better days, Brett. Trying to build something in Fayetteville. And their five remaining opponents, as Todd said, tough schedule. Nine straight running plays, and they've used about 5.5 minutes off the clock. Empty set again, and it's a quarterback run all the way again. Trying to follow his blocker is going to be short of the first down as Peters made the hit. We check in with Holly.
Well, Alabama getting their backup quarterback Blake Sims some reps, but also their third string center. Chad Lindsey's gone out of the game, and Kellen Williams, who did get some action at guard in this game, he's now playing center. Now, Ryan Kelly was available to play tonight in emergency, but they're going to give his knee another week's rest, try to maybe get him ready for the LSU game down the road. But, man, where do you ever get a cross-train your third-string center? I guess you're doing it tonight.
Yes, they are.
Is he big enough, though, Holly? That's the question I have. She usually is very concerned.
Well, he's 202 pounds out of Lawrenceville, Georgia. That's pretty good-sized. Again, Blake Sims fakes one way, comes back the other, tried to stay in bounds, and didn't get the first down. Jared Collins hung in there to make the tackle. You know, when you go into a coach's meeting and Holly says to the head coach, I'm concerned about your center. You know it's going to be a fun meeting at that point. There's Ryan Kelly, the sophomore who started earlier in the year, and then Lindsey, and now Kellen Williams.
Well, and remember, Ryan Kelly was replacing one of the all-time greats here at Alabama.
Barrett Jones.
Yep, Barrett Jones played three different positions as a starter at a very high level during his career, but probably best remembered as their center as Alabama gets stopped on fourth down.
Won an Outland Trophy at two different spots. Yeah. Try to do that in your career. Well, that's the first time Alabama has done something where we say, well, they're human. They turn the ball over on downs. Time for our Discover Game Changer. Obviously, A.J. McCarron can change a lot of games. He did tonight, 15 out of 21, 180 yards. Touchdowns to Fowler, his tight end, Amari Cooper right there. And then the big tight end, the freshman, O.J. Howard. That wasn't all the offense tonight for Alabama, though. Kenyon Drake, over 100 yards for the second straight week, including a couple of touchdowns. This one a 46-yarder where he cut outside, used his speed, and headed down the sideline. Our game changers tonight. Arkansas takes over at the 43-yard line. And Collins on a cutback run, switches the ball to his right hand, a stiff arm of his own, and goes out close to the 40-yard line as we go out to Reese Davis. Reese.
All right, Brian, LSU trying to get back in it on ESPN2 against Ole Miss. Down by 10. Zach Mettenberger is going to be sacked by Isaac Gross. Let me give you a note here. Mettenberger against Ole Miss in two starts in his career, no touchdowns, five interceptions. Only two multiple interception games of his career.
Wow. So Ole Miss playing better than we've seen him play in a while. Holding on to a touchdown lead. Here Alabama pitching another shutout, much like the Ole Miss game that we saw earlier this year. Collins, tough run, and he picked up the first down. Ryan Anderson made the stop. Collins started off his freshman season with three straight 100-yard games. And the last true freshman to do that, we'll see on Monday Night Football, Adrian Peterson. He ripped off nine straight in his freshman season at Oklahoma. P.J. Hill did it for Brett Bielema at Wisconsin, too, but P.J. was a redshirt freshman. Some more trivia for you. I know you're soaking up all I can give you right now, Todd.
You're a giver.
Jonathan Williams hits it out to midfield. So Alabama will run their winning streak to 11 straight. Ohio State had their hands full today, but they keep their winning streak alive. And
we'll see
be in action
week.
At home next week. We'll see them.
Kind of looking forward to seeing them. And, you know, we've seen some of these undefeated teams. Of course, Stanford is no longer undefeated. They were when we saw them.
Right. Second down and five. Fullback straight up the middle. He's got a first down. Kiero Small. Holly.
Unveiled a beautiful new trophy case in the lobby of their football building this week. Mal Moore, their former athletic director who passed away this summer, his family has donated all of his bowl watches, championship rings, and it is one of the most beautiful displays of memorabilia I think I've ever seen. It was just stunning. There's a radio from the 1951 Liberty Bowl that the players got as a gift. A ring from Bear Bryant's 315th ring, and believe it or not, 10 national championships rings. He was part of 10 of their 15 as either a player or an administrator.
That's some serious jewelry right there. Collins, nice cutback run. And this kid's not done yet. Collins still going down to the 30-yard line. His best run of the night.
Now watch him at the end of the play. He'll get up and hand the ball to the official.
Well, he would have. He dropped it.
I like his style. And, you know, if he keeps going like this, you know, Brett's going to keep building this team. I mean, he's going to recruit linemen. They're going to get a little bit better in their passing game. They're going to get a little bit better on defense. This is a good guy you can build around.
You bet.
You know, and he's had backs like that when he was at Wisconsin. And you build it with offensive linemen and a hard-nosed fullback and guys that like to run the football. And he's got one in Alex Collins. And he inherited one in Jonathan Williams, too.
Between the two of them, they've got seven 100-yard performances on the year. So that's definitely something to build on. This kid breaks another tackle. And he's heading towards 70 yards on the night right there. Alex Collins, we mentioned Fort Lauderdale. And there's the first three games with 100 plus and averaging over 100. Not quite there tonight, but he's not quitting right now. That's for sure.
Well, I'll tell you who else is not quitting right now is Kirby Smart, because, you know, we talked about Vinny Censuri talking about they don't want to give up anything, and that touchdown drive in the Kentucky game, even though you got second and third teamers out there, those guys don't want to give up this shutout.
This is the 18th straight run in this game between the two teams. There's Kirby. One of the most highly respected defensive coordinators anywhere.
Yeah, that'd be a, you know, that a tough job. You being a defensive coordinator for Nick Saban.
Yeah.
And not only that, but your specialty is the secondary, and that's also Nick Saban's specialty. So you get a double whammy of Nick over your shoulder.
There they are. Right on cue. cue. First down, just inside the 21. Deepest penetration for Arkansas tonight. Bootleg. Nobody to throw to again. So Brandon Allen has to throw it all the way to the first row of the seats. Mitchell Lovin was the intended receiver. Kirby obviously will be a head coach probably sooner rather than later, but considers this one of the great jobs in college football.
Well, there's no better person to learn under, that's for sure. Not just the X's and O's, but the overall management of a program. Because Nick Saban is as good as it gets when it comes to that.
Alex Collins in a wildcat set here. And broke one tackle and another before spinning inside the 15-yard line. Holly.
One of the ways Kirby Smart copes with the stress of coaching here at Alabama, before the game last time we were here, I caught him on the bench right before the game, about 30 minutes before, with his earbuds in. He was listening to the Pandora channel for Mumford & Sons. He said, you know, I just try to get a little peace before the game.
A lot of the times he said it's a Zach Brown band. Right now he's trying to keep Arkansas out of that end zone and preserve the shutout, and the fans are trying to help. Third and five. Allen to the corner and incomplete. Nice job by Cyrus Jones over there. The coverage on DeArthur Cohen. So it's down to one more play here for Arkansas. Brandon Allen has been incomplete on his last eight attempts. He's going to have one more shot right here. Trying to preserve the shutout. Fourth and five. Allen rolling left. Pressure from the side. He got hammered as he threw. And it's broken up in the end zone. Maurice Smith knocked it down. And Alabama takes over on downs. And C.J. Mosley congratulates some of the backup players on this play. Probably the last chance for the Hogs. Alabama takes over, and the shutout continues in Tuscaloosa. Celebrating its ninth year sponsoring the Good Hands Field Goal Nets, Allstate makes contributions to participating university general scholarship funds for each field goal and extra point kicked. To this point, Allstate's contributed more than $3 million in scholarship funds. Cade Foster's hit the nets seven times tonight. Unfortunately for Arkansas, they haven't had a kick go through the nets tonight.
Well, Nick Saban told Holly at halftime they needed to clean a few things up. Still trying to figure out what was dirty. But here we are with a minute 50 left, and Alabama, for the second week in a row, on a day when it's been upsets all over the SEC, we've had a second consecutive dominant performance by Alabama. 447 yards, no penalties, no turnovers, no sacks.
Right.
Gee.
You don't have to clean much. It's a really small spot that you have to clean.
I mean, when's the last game we did when a team had no penalties?
I don't
even remember one.
I don't either. Final 1:15. Sims taking his time on the snap to Henry. Henry on the cutback. Got the corner. Big guy rumbling. Henry down the sideline. He might take it. 238 pounds and 80 yards. Touchdown. Whoa.
Wow.
There's another piece of the pie. That sweet apple pie. Oh, man. I didn't know that cat could move that fast.
He's got some wheels now. I mean, I know the defense is tired and wants to get back to Fayetteville, but this guy turned the corner and was gone.
I kept waiting for the wheels to wobble, and those babies were spinning perfectly. Griffith's extra point is good. You're not going to see too many guys this big, folks, do what this guy just did.
And all night, it's been the zone play with the cutback that's hurt Arkansas. We saw Drake do it. We saw Yeldon do it. Now we see the big fella, Henry, do it.
Holy smokes. A two-play drive. 80 of it is the freshman from Yulee, Florida. And he looked like he was heading to Florida down the sideline. Man, oh, man.
Those eyes got big when he saw the end zone, too, man. Wow.
That is a big dude moving at a high rate of speed. 50, what's the score? 52-0. Longest play this year for Alabama. Ironically, this is what happened a year ago against Arkansas. Same score. As a mini bear. Alabama's got 352 yards on the ground. Wow. Yep. I think they're just warming up. The guys in the crimson. Well, we've been here twice, partner, along with Holly, and we haven't seen the opposition score a point yet.
No, we have not.
Adam Griffith again to kick.
My man, Scott Cochran, still jumping up and down for the fourth quarter. Every play of the fourth quarter, even in the last 58 seconds.
Marshall dropped the ball, picks it up, tries to get out near the 20. 52 seconds left in a 52-0 game. Nick Saban in the background, and he's going, oh no, this is going to make it look like I ran up the score.
But you can't tell the guy not to score.
Absolutely,
you know,
it's a zone play.
It's a zone play. He busted it out the backside. He's a freshman.
He wants to play, and he wants to win just like the rest of the guys do. That's what a smile on a 238-pounder looks like 80 yards later. And Jonathan Williams down to another play, and that's about it. Alabama, their schedule, we talked about the Razorbacks having a tough schedule coming up. As you look ahead for Alabama, you can put the W down for Arkansas.
Yep.
Tennessee and LSU, then on the road twice in the last 3 weeks, including at Auburn. And of course, last year that would look like an easy one. That doesn't look easy at all anymore. Probably the final snap as Williams goes down, and so does Arkansas. And Tennessee, you are next if you were watching, but you got a big win today.
That's the game. Alabama.
52-0 is the final. Tough day for Brett Bielema. There'll be better outings. There won't be too many much better than what we just saw from Alabama. Don't forget, Sports Center is coming up next. Everybody got a piece of that sweet apple pie in the Alabama offense, and the defense does its job with a shutout. For Todd Blackledge and Holly Rowe and our entire ESPN crew, Brad Nessler saying so long from Tuscaloosa. Number one with a bullet, 52-0.